G'day everyone, and welcome back to a huge episode of Round Ball Rules. It is Wednesday, which means it's time to talk A-League football, it's time to talk Matildas, and of course, the Socceroos, because the squad has been announced for the 2022 World Cup in Qatar in just 2 weeks' time. I'm Robbie Thomson, and I'm joined on the couch by Andy Harper and Simon Hill. Gentlemen.
Good to see you, Robbie.
Absolutely. So you got your kit for the World Cup. You were picked yesterday. Congratulations.
I'm ready.
You look fantastic in your
I'm old enough to have just about worn the 1974 kit, actually.
Yeah. Well, thank God you're out of that PSG stuff for the time being anyway.
There was a toss-up. I was actually thinking about that. I've got so many PSG T-shirts and stuff. It's a wonder they can pay the players with the amount of gear that I took from that club when I left. But let's get straight into it without any further ado, because yesterday was the moment everyone had been waiting for, the announcement of the Socceroos squad for Qatar. Gentlemen, there were surprises, there were omissions, there were inclusions. Overall, I think people are generally pretty happy with the squad, actually. There's the big inclusions of like Garang Kuol, which people were calling for. Jason Cummings is there. Certainly there's a very strong Scottish influence. There's a strong Mariners influence in this side. Was that? I leave that to you, being a Northern Englishman, just about Scottish, Simon.
I have Scottish heritage.
There we go. Yeah. So, what do we think? Where should we start? Inclusions, first of all. There was so much talk about Cummings and Kuol. Happy, Simon?
Yeah, I think overall, I'm glad that Garang Kuol's there. I thought he needed to be on the plane, particularly given the form that he's in. Obviously, he's not going to start in Qatar. We know that. But he can provide a bit of the X factor off the bench. So I'm glad that he's there. Glad that Jason Cummings has made it. I think he offers something a little bit different in attack to the likes of Jamie McLaren and Mitch Duke, etc. Obviously, the bigger talking points are the omissions, but I guess we'll get onto that. What about you, Harps?
Yeah,
overall, are you happy or not?
Look, I don't think at any point when a squad's announced, there's a call for a mass overhaul of the coaches' selections. I mean, basically, 90% of the squad.
I think there could have been. If there'd been no Garang Kuol, I think there would have been big outcry in Australia.
Possibly, but this is not a squad where you can just say, well, just, this is a complete change of direction. I mean, there's always the case. There's a measure of predictability that goes with this because we're familiar with the coach and the types of players that he's been employing through the various games in the campaign. So it's on the margins where the discussion is, and you know, the ones that call, I mean, one of the most bizarre things really when you want to look at it is Cummins and Cam Devlin. So Cam Devlin has had to leave Australia and go to Scotland to get picked, and Jason Cummins has had to leave Scotland and come to Australia to get picked.
But more importantly, they've had to leave to get real playing time. Well, Cammy Devlin's been playing a lot. I guess he was playing in Australia as well. But Cummings had to come here to play. Mm-hmm. He needed to find football.
No, of course, and his emergence as a personality in the league. This all gets back to me, to Nick Montgomery, the coach of the Mariners. Yeah. I mean, you would have to. The CV for Jason was damaged goods. I reckon that was why he ended up coming the other side of the world. And Nick Montgomery saw the talent, has decided to embark on this journey to straighten Jason's football application and output. And it's worked a treat, not only for Mariners, but now for the lad himself who's going to go to a World Cup.
Well, they're the only club out of the A-League that have got three representatives, Stani Vukovic, Garang Kuol and Jason Cummings. So, you know, that's evidence that Monty is doing something right. Yeah. And I'm glad that Jason Cummings is there. I think he's earned his spot. I thought it might have been a bit, you know, touch and go as to whether he got in because there's a lot of competition for those places in attack. But in the end, he's made it. And Adam Taggart, who I expected to be a part of the squad, hasn't.
Mm. Yeah, well, there are a few players who are omitted. Just before we talk about those that aren't there, and we are going to have that discussion, 7 A-League players. It's great. I mean, we're champions of the A-League. I think most people watching enjoy the A-League as well. That's why you're here watching for the A-League chat. But the likes of McLaren and Leckie, we expected that. Redmayne is there as well. Craig Goodwin has been outstanding. And the three Mariners. I mean, it's a great reward for the A-League, if you like. Well, for so many years, we had only foreigners and foreign players coming back. And that was great. And the team was a great quality. And we had the players playing overseas. But here, the A-League has got its chance to step up, hasn't it?
Not only the 7 players who currently play for A-League clubs, but 18 out of the 26 either started their careers in the A-League or came through the A-League at a certain point to relaunch their careers. So, you know, I've said this a lot. I think our league suffers from an awful lot of hostility from within its own population, both inside and outside the game. And it probably gets more respect overseas than it does in this country in large part. But there's no doubt that there is talent there. And, you know, the fact that of those other 11 players who play overseas but have played in the A-League have gone overseas shows that those overseas clubs rate our competition, rate our players. And Garang Kuol is going to be the latest of them.
Yeah, and it's, look, there's a couple of points to this. Firstly, and undeniably, the flow of Australian players to the top leagues of Europe has slowed alarmingly, and we need to reinvigorate that. So that's part of this discussion. The other part is, to Simon's point, and I couldn't agree any more, the people who are in the belly of the beast, in the cocoon of Australian A-League clubs and now in the national team, know what a tough competition A-League men's is. You know, this has got bona fide professional tensile strength. You don't pick these players unless you respect what they're doing. Now the noise outside the competition from fans or not fans making judgments about where the league sits in the international pecking order is a discussion that's not illegitimate, but it's not relevant according to the people who are in the cocoon knowing what it takes to survive in the A-League. It's built its professional credentials as a robust competition, the training requirements. It's not easy. And to have seven picked is a representation, to me, of the fact that the people in the game know and respect exactly what's happening on the field. And, of course, around that discussion is the movement of players to the top leagues, which we need to accelerate. But that doesn't take away from what the A-League has achieved over the 15, 16 years since it's been going.
Just one more point on this. We spoke to Joe Lolley on my radio show on Tuesday night, and I asked him, has anything surprised you about your time in Australia, on or off the pitch? And he said, the one thing that surprised me the most was the technical level of the competition. And he said the physical intensity sometimes isn't quite the same because that we play in a different sort of climate here to what he's used to over in England, where he played in the Championship, of course, for Nottingham Forest for a large part of his career. But he said the technical level here is the thing that has surprised him the most.
Yeah. He wasn't surprised that there are no kangaroos in the middle of Sydney.
I didn't ask him that.
Fair enough. Joe Lolley. Okay. Obviously done his research. Those players that missed out.
Yeah.
Mitch Langerak is obviously the biggest one because of the fact that he'd been called back just 3 months ago, 2 months ago for those friendlies against New Zealand. He didn't play a minute against New Zealand, and now Danny Vukovic has been recalled, if you like. I mean, it's the three goalkeepers that were there against the UAE and Peru. It's the three goalkeepers that were there at the moment the Socceroos qualified for this World Cup. But what's the feeling around that one? We'll talk specifically about that one, and then we'll talk more about defenders, midfielders, forwards that may have missed out. But this is the one that's really focusing the attention of the pundits at the moment. Harps for you, Mitch Langerak?
The clear line around this is that the three have been picked, and first and foremost, not to rain on their parade, excellent players, fantastic goalkeepers, great football citizens. So what we say now about the Mitch Langerak absence is not to detract from any of the three. I want to make that really clear, right? However, the clear line of delineation is that the three who've been picked have come through the John Crawley goalkeeping school. Now, don't misinterpret what I'm saying here. This is not, you know, because they're out of my academy. It's not that sort of thing. But John Crawley is the goalkeeper coach. I'm assuming Graham Arnold has deferred to John's expertise.
He said as much yesterday in the press conference.
And so in that sense, you know, John Crawley knows these three intimately, has coached them, trained them, and feels comfortable with that. I can only assume that Mitch Langerak hasn't fitted in to that scaffolding. When you look at it, though, if you're Mitch Langerak or you're any player with that form over the last 4 or 5 years, that status in the game in Japan, in the J-League, best goalkeeper in the J-League, year after year virtually, he'd have to be thinking, what the hell do I have to do? What the hell do I have to do to get picked? And that's what I think looking at it. It's quite remarkable, really.
Is he paying the penalty, Simon, for retiring for that spell? Even if everyone said, we understand why, he's got a young family in Japan, border controls were very tight during COVID. He did remove himself from selection for that period. We've seen that in other areas.
There are two things that puzzle me about this. You're right that he, to all intents and purposes, retired for a brief spell. For completely understandable reasons, because of COVID, he couldn't get in and out of Japan. He's got a family there, etc. So if he's paying the price for that, then why was he recalled?
And Matthew Leckie made the same decision.
Yeah. So why was he recalled and then got no minutes against New Zealand? Okay, that's one point. The second point, which I think is more pertinent from a football point of view, is that Matty Ryan, who we all know is the number one and the captain and is going to play, providing he's fit. He's got a bit of a knee problem at the moment. He's not playing regularly for FC Copenhagen. So if there's a problem with Matty Ryan, now again, this is nothing against Danny Vukovic or Andrew Redmayne, who are super goalkeepers, but to me, the obvious replacement for Matty Ryan, if he's not right, is Mitch Langerak, because he's the form goalkeeper. He's the one that's playing every week in a really good competition in Japan. It's a total head-scratcher for me. But you know what? Arnie's made big calls before with regards to goalkeepers on the advice of John Crawley. We saw that with Andrew Redmayne. You remember ahead of the Peru and UAE games, we're all going, why is Mark Birigitti not in this squad? He should be there ahead of Redmayne. There was a method behind the madness. Yeah. So, you know, maybe we should trust in the process. But having said that, for me, I would have picked Mitch Langerak in this squad. I think it's bizarre that he's not there, quite frankly.
And I sort of take the view, it's not to challenge John Crawley, you know, it's more about goalkeeping, you know, that I'll even be able to read. So this is not to challenge the decision per se. I'm trying to put myself in the shoes of a player, purely from that viewpoint of Mitch Langerak, who's produced massively in recent times. Massively. Like, unbettered, really. I think his success has been unparalleled in the goalkeeping ranks. So, not to challenge the process, not to challenge the three who got picked, just to try and put yourself in the shoes of Mitch Langerak, the Thierry Tiger, and think, how did I not make this squad? I think on a human level, you have to, all the guys who missed out, but most acutely with Mitch Langerak at the moment.
If you're Mitch Langerak now, Harps, are you sitting there back in Japan, not only bemoaning the fact that you're not going to the World Cup, but thinking, well, you know what, I think that's me done with Australia?
Well, I'd hope not, because he's got a lot of goalkeeping still to play. If he's thinking about winding up his career, that's my chance gone. But, you know, Mitch has still got another World Cup cycle in him at the top level. And if that's the case, well, he'll be watching very closely what happens post-World Cup, because then the discussion about Graham Arnold's, well, his tenure finishes with this World Cup. Does he get another crack at it? You know, that will certainly, I reckon, play into Mitch's view. But if it's a clean slate with a new coach, which from my point of view is the expectation, because Football Australia have said at the end of this cycle we're going in a different direction, and then that might breathe some life into Mitch's international aspirations. Yeah. But for the here and now, you've got to feel for a guy. A career high has passed him by, and not because of anything he's done.
Two more things I want to talk about. The first, players that missed out. There are the likes of Marco Tilio, Arzani, the talk in that those attacking players who was going to miss out. Taggart has missed out as well in that number nine role, as we mentioned. Trent Sainsbury missed out. He's been a stalwart in the Socceroos for years.
Let's, and along years. With Langerak, he's the big one.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And then there's also someone like Connor Metcalf, Denis Jeanreau, who have been featuring.
Tommy Rogic.
Well, that's the second point I want to get to.
How long's the first point, Robbie? Well, that's that's longer than mine.
That's the first point.
I mean, what is the point?
There is no point. So now to you guys, to sum up, those players that have missed out, obviously you have to make decisions. Sainsbury missing out for you, Simon. Yeah, that's the big one. Are you surprised by it, though?
I'm surprised. I mean, okay,
Trent. We know the relationship between Arnie and Trent Sainsbury. Not that that should come into it, but he is the son-in-law of the national team
Which
coach.
Means that they probably won't be coming around for Christmas dinner after the World Cup. But I'm surprised by it, not because Trent has been in scintillating form for Australia, because he hasn't been of late, let's be honest. And he's lacking a bit of game time. But so is Matty Ryan at the moment, and one or two others. So I don't know whether that can be the definitive. Well, Joel King's not playing an awful lot for Odense, and he's picked. So he's been training with Melbourne City. Again, personally, I would have taken Trent purely because there are a couple of injury concerns over Harry Sutter and Kai Rolls. I know that they're back fit, but they're not match fit, if you like. They haven't played for a while. And I think Trent's experience in the World Cup arena would have been useful. So I think that's a big call. I can understand why he's done it, but I think it's a massive call. And obviously there's the Tommy Rogic thing as well, but go on.
Let's go to that second point then.
Okay. So we did finish the first point.
Tommy Rogic.
Yes.
Obviously Arnie has been in contact with him.
Yeah.
The general consensus was if Tommy is available and fit, and willing to play, then he would be a great addition to the squad. Mm. Can we also put into that Christian Volpato, Alessandro Circati, the young Italian central, Australian-Italian central defender at Parma, who's been playing a lot in Serie B? Arnie was speaking to both of those two Italian-based Australian, Italo-Australians who have, in theory, Volpato we heard about yesterday, he tried three times the day before, he had him in the 26. I'm not sure what the exact status was for Circati, but I know that in windows before that, Arnie's been trying to invite him to come in for the friendly games against New Zealand. And Tommy Rogic. If Tommy Rogic has turned it down, where do these guys stand now, Harps? And this is the minefield. And we don't have all the information around why they're making these decisions. Christian Volpato has just released a statement.
Saying...
To point three.
Because we've already forgotten point two.
There is a half a point three still to come. Christian Volpato has basically said, look, I'm concentrating on my club football. This is a big decision for me at the start of my career and one that I'm not comfortable in making at the moment.
So of all the noises, pronouncements, explanations that Graham Arnold has produced, and I admire him for being as objective as anyone could ever be in cutting his son-in-law, who is an institution in this generation of players. That's a massive call. Mm. So I admire the strength that would have taken, really, from Graham Arnold. On the negative side, to hear that he was still up until 11 p.m. before deadline day, still trying to get in contact with Volpato, that concerns me. Because I want to know how that goes through the rest of the squad. Mm. So here's a guy who's resisted, and Christian, a fantastic opportunity he's got with Roma, full of admiration. His decision on his heritage and which he feels the most expressive about is completely his, and I utterly respect it. So he hasn't declared any sort of interest. Hasn't accepted any invitations to be involved. That's fine, including the most recent matches. That's fine. So listening to then Coach Arnold, it's like till midnight of the night before, I'm trying to get this guy in sight unseen with the squad and make him a Socceroo and then to play. What does that say to the other guys in the squad?
And who was the 27th man?
And who was the 27th?
Who's now part of the 26th?
Well, so at, you know, that cord, I mean, it's hard to manage this stuff, but... hearing that, my first reaction is I would have wanted that cord cut a lot earlier than 11 p.m. before. Do you understand what I'm trying to say?
Yeah, but I mean, you could even take that back to the New Zealand games where he opened the door and called up so many new players and said, look, everyone's got the chance. And those that have been in the squad up until now, you know, maybe you're not. Maybe this is just a continuation.
Well, that would have, you know, whenever the. Let me put it this way. Whatever your cutoff date is in your own mind as the leader of this ship, it's surely got to be earlier than 11 p.m.
It really was the 11th hour.
Yeah, it's the 11th hour. Anyway, so that's point two and a half.
Yeah.
If we go back to point two, 2.0,
yeah.
Tommy Rogic.
Yeah.
No surprise.
That's point three, wasn't it?
No, point three is still to come.
No surprise.
Yeah.
Disappointed not to watch Tommy.
Yeah.
But he hasn't presented a case in recent history. And is there any lingering... stench, too strong a word, about his unavailability and uncontactability. Yeah.
Again, to your point, Harps, if he had been selected, obviously he wasn't, but if he had been, how would that have then played out with the rest of the squad who did put themselves forward for the games against the UAE and Peru? So maybe that formed a part of the thinking, but I think overall he's just not been visible enough in terms of his club football, in recent months at least.
I mean, a club will not want to keep a player that doesn't feel they have the capacity to give their all in a match. And maybe Tommy Rogic felt that in those playoff games, that burnout and whatever and leaving Celtic, he wasn't in a position to go on and give it everything in those games. And maybe, you know, you have to have that and say, look, okay, no, but it's better for us not...
Yeah, he's entitled absolutely. To that, completely entitled to that.
You know, it speaks volumes, though, that at 2019 Asian Cup, Tommy Rogic was part of the Asian team of the tournament. Mm. And if you'd have thought that, you know, 3 years on, the major talking point would be Mitch Langerak first, Trent Sainsbury second, and Tommy Rogic third, and quite a distant third, probably, you know, speaks volumes, which is unfortunate because, for me, along with Aaron Moy, he's the most talented Australian player of his generation.
Mm. Yeah. Okay, point three we got there. Only just, it has to be very quick because we're getting the wind-up.
Yeah, that's right.
We mustn't forget that we're playing three matches. It wasn't just all about choosing a 26-man squad. We're actually going to play. Mm. So we've got France on the 22nd. Then Tunisia on the 26th, Denmark on the 30th. What can we expect?
Well, you can
from
tell us what's
going
to happen against France. Come on, you're the expert there.
Well, France, we can talk about what we're going to see, which I'm not going to tell you the France squad. Didier told me not to say anything on round ball rules.
Is Giroud in it?
I imagine Olivier Giroud will be looking to break his drought at World Cups as well, because, of course, he didn't score in the number nine position. But the French have a long history of that, with Givache in 98 not scoring.
Christophe Dugarry.
Exactly. Oh, he scored. But anyway. Yeah. No, so what do we think of this squad and how we're going to go? Obviously, France are world champions. France have been struggling of late. They lost to Denmark recently. They didn't defend their Nations League title. Tunisia are going to be a tricky side as well, with the strong European influence in that. And Denmark, we know what that character has and that side and the quality of their players, who are many of them playing Champions League football in Europe as well. Harps, you go first. What do we expect from...
Well, at the order of the games...
Are we going to park the bus, first of all?
In a manner of speaking, probably. But the order of the games is key. And the difference this time from last time, virtually identical groups, is that the game that you would earmark to win is now game two rather than game three. And I think that's significant because, you know, if you rotate... If you haven't got a lot of depth in your squad, you've still got 26 players. But if when you're managing the actual... on-field formula, you don't feel you can go very deep beyond, then by the time you get to game three, those players haven't probably got enough petrol in the tank for the effort to required to beat a World Cup opponent in game three. My point is, of the three teams, Simon, Tunisia, we don't know much about, and we haven't played African opponents much recently. They're going to be incredibly difficult. But of the three, needing to get through with a win doing that, Tunisia's the game that's targeted. Comes game two, and I think that's perfect scheduling. As good as you can get. So you come out of the France game holding water still, if not winning, but not having a blowout in the goal difference. Then you get to Tunisia, you put everything into that because that's the game you have to win. You've got to win at least one to get through. And then a puncher's chance against Denmark. That's my summation of the group.
I wouldn't disagree with that. I think... You know, allied to that is the fact that France have had a history of starting major tournaments rather slowly, which can happen to major
champions
nations.
Champions generally do.
Yeah. They've had a history of making the finals and the next World Cup being an absolute disaster. 2002, 2010.
And, you know, in case we forget, they've got a couple of injuries as well. Paul Pogba's out, N'Golo Kante's out. Okay, they've still got Mbappe and Griezmann and
Kingsley Coman.
They've got some great, fantastic players. And, you know, 9.5 times out of 10, they're going to beat Australia. Let's be brutally honest about it. But opening game at a World Cup, we did the same, you know, 4 years ago, we played the same opponents and they needed a penalty to get over the line. I agree with Harps, game two is key. If we're going to win a game, it's against Tunisia. And then all of a sudden, you're looking at the Denmark game, who again, we played 4 years ago, got a draw against Denmark. Yeah. 4 points might be enough to get you through if we don't have a blowout in the first game. Now, that's very easy for me to sit here and say that. You look at the Danes, Christian Eriksen, who's back to something approaching his best, Kasper Dolberg, goodness me, Simon Kjær at the back. They're a quality side. Mm-hmm. So are France. The Tunisians won't be any walkover either. Yeah. It's a World Cup. It shouldn't be. But I think there's a possibility. I'm not saying it's a probability, but I think there's a possibility we could get through.
It means, listening to both of you, that 3 points against Tunisia will have to be part of that equation.
Yes.
I mean, depending on what happens. And Tunisia probably, from my understanding...
They'll be thinking the same thing.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, absolutely. But they're not in that top tier of African football. No. They're not the Egypt, Senegal, Morocco...
No, but you look, the 4 years ago, the same was said about Peru in the South American context, right?
And Peru gave France a big push as well.
They were the best team in the group.
Yeah. Yeah.
They were the best
they
team in the group.
Australia.
They smashed Denmark and couldn't get anything out of it.
They could have been in front against France.
They were gone. Australia had done. They'd run their race by that Peru game. So, you know, there's a very distinct possibility that Tunisia could not just be Peru as a cut and paste. They could be Peru as the embodiment of an African team that no one's expecting, but with a generation of talent that can do something.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. That's it for the Socceroos chat. We are all looking forward now to the early start on Wednesday, the 23rd of November, when Australia play France in that opening match of the World Cup. The Matildas are in action before then. The Matildas have two games on home soil as they continue to work towards the next World Cup, hosted here. Matildas Sweden on Saturday and Matildas Thailand on the following Tuesday. So the Matildas returning to Melbourne for the first time in 3.5 years. against the side that knocked them out of the semi-finals of the Olympic Games. Andy Harper, there are some big talking points. The Matildas coming off a couple of good results, South Africa and Denmark, in the last window. Elise Kellen-Knight is back. That's a big addition to the squad. She's finally ready after having played a season in Sweden since coming back from injury. I think it's the first time in over a year and a half that she's called up. Claire Polkinghorne, it could be match number 150 for her, just one behind Cheryl Salisbury. And of course, it's the coach up against his compatriots.
Yeah.
Where do we start? Can Australia build on that win over Denmark and Sweden, their next level again?
They
Sweden are.
Are
number two in the world ranking at the moment.
Yeah, I mean, this is the toughest opponent Australia's played. They did have them twice in the Olympics, so they've got a good form guide against which to compare this game on Saturday night. You know, Sweden, I think, has continued to make ground since the Olympics, and I can't say the same about the Matildas. They're still treading water as a team, with the combinations, with the coach's decision, the direction that the team's going, the options around the field. I don't think when you look at Sweden and Australia post-Olympics, you could say they're on par. With the trajectory of the team. Now, it's going to be a really big crowd, a real acid test for a serious contender for the World Cup in Sweden, slightly tempered by the absence of two big-name players. So Aslani's not coming, Kosovar Aslani, outstanding AC Milan player.
Ex-PSG.
Ex-PSG, of course, everyone's ex-PSG, aren't they? Are you ex-PSG?
There are a lot of them.
No.
Caroline Sager, their veteran captain, is also ex-PSG.
Right. And Fridolina Rodolfo, who's at Barcelona, one of the world's...
Rolfo.
She's one of the best attackers in the world. And so that's going to be a bit of respite for the Matildas on Saturday. But the Thailand game will take care of itself. You know, that'll be a bit of a punching bag for the Matildas. Should be, and we can get some attacking fluency going, score some goals. That's the expectation. Sweden, another thing altogether. It's going to be on for young and old on the Saturday, and I'm not quite sure how they're going to go, to be honest with you.
But Simon, that's what we want, isn't it? Big games.
Of course.
You have to measure yourself against the best that are going to be coming here next year looking to win.
There's no doubt about that. And you know, one of the things I would love to see, and I know the Australian public loves seeing all the star names, the centre of defence in particular has been an issue for the Matildas. The defence as a whole has been an issue, let's be honest. Particularly in the continued absence of Ellie Carpenter, and hopefully she'll be back for the Women's World Cup. With Elise Kellen-Knight coming back in, we know she can play as a left fullback. I would like to see, at least for maybe part of the game, because I don't know how match fit KK is, she's only just back, to see her play at left back and move Steph Catley into the central defence to play alongside either Alana Kennedy or Claire Polkinghorne, just to see if that's a combination that could potentially work. Because they are all experienced players. KK has played that role before. Maybe that's a potential solution, even if it's only for 20 minutes, half an hour against Sweden. That's one of the things I'd like to do. I'd also like to see Alex Chidiak play in midfield. I think she's earned a shot because, you know, time is now getting short ahead of the Women's World Cup. We've seen a little bit of experimentation from Tony Gustafsson, but, you know, maybe not a whole lot. Anyway, it'll be fascinating to see how they go against Sweden because, you know, that's the sort of team they're going to have to beat if they're going to go a long way in the World Cup.
Well, the return of Elise Kellen-Knight is fantastic. One of my favourites. You know, back-to-back FIFA World 11s in consecutive World Cups. You're talking a player of enormous repute in women's football and a shocking run with that knee. So a knee reconstruction, then post-reconstructive surgery again and hasn't featured under Gustafsson, but he'd know a lot about her. And she's a great cut-and-paste player. It just goes to show if she is to be an option for left fullback, and Simon's right to identify that, it just goes to show that the lack of squad growth that Gustafsson has been able to manipulate since he's been in charge. She's still talking about Tamika Yallop sometimes playing left fullback. Courtney Nevin sometimes playing left fullback. You're still trying to find that who's the next Steph Catley. We lost one who went to Ali Green, who went to New Zealand. She never got a chance. So Steph to the centre of defence is a tried and tested fullback position. But moving her from left fullback takes away an enormous attacking option for the team.
Does.
So, but great to see KK back. And just on Chidiak as well, the best news of the recent couple of weeks is the union of Chidiak and Kellen-Knight at Melbourne Victory in the upcoming A-League women's season. Yeah. That's going to be so good.
Well, it's great that Chidiak's now a regular in the squad as well, because for a while people were saying, where's Chidiak? She came back to Australia and she still wasn't Now she's a regular in the squad. The next step is to get more minutes, perhaps, with the Matildas. We get to see all of that on Saturday and Tuesday on Network 10. That's it for the first segment. We'll get changed out of these, get on the A-League strips, because we're going to talk round 5 and look ahead to round 6 of the A-League. Round 6 kicks off this Friday with the original rivalry. It's Adelaide hosting Melbourne Victory. Welcome back to Round Ball Rules with Simon Hill, Andy Harper on the couch with myself, Robbie Thomson. Time to look back at Round 5 of the A-League season and all the results. There were plenty of goals, 26 of them in our 6 matches. That's 4.5 goals per game, if my maths is correct. That's not necessarily the case. 4.25.
Well, I mean, the Wanderers-Mariners game was
lots
boring,
of goals.
Wasn't it?
There's
only 3.
Melbourne Victory got it all underway with a 4-0 win against the Jets. That will make for an interesting A-League's all-access episode because it was following around Arthur Pappas, the Jets coach. We can't all have 4-0 victories or big derby wins when you're on A-League's all-access, so that will be just as entertaining to see, I'm sure. Melbourne City still undefeated, the only undefeated side. They were far too good for Perth Glory. The Mariners, that was a demonstration, wasn't it, gents, against the Western Sydney Wanderers. 3-0, the first defeat of the season for the Wanderers. The Phoenix looked very, very good against Macarthur. We're going to have a chat about them in a moment. Brisbane Roar, that was the big surprise, perhaps, of the weekend. 3-1 winners over Sydney. And then Western United, with a couple of second-half goals, making it look respectable. But really, we'll start there, perhaps, with a little wrap-up. Andy Harper, Western United... champions without a win, 4 losses and 1 draw in 5 to begin their title defence. Our alarm bell's ringing now. They've been, all the word out of the camp has been, training is still good. Yeah. This is going to turn the corner. We're playing well. We're still pressing well. Things are going to turn our way, but they've got to turn sooner rather than later.
Oh, well, if there's not alarm bells yet, there'll soon be alarm megaphones around the place. Yeah. I mean, it's a very depressing read. And is there something wrong with Leo Lacroix?
That's one of the big talking points.
That is
isn't
the
it?
Talking I mean, point.
Yeah.
That is the talking point.
Well, it's not. You can't defend by yourself.
No,
so
no,
he's
no.
not the only element, but he is a leader at the back.
Bouquets and brickbats.
Yeah.
So last year they were doing the boring Arsenal thing, winning 1-0, getting to the top of the comp, setting the establishing the foundation to win the championship. And foremost in that discussion last year was Leo Lacroix. Yep. Wow, what a fantastic player. Yep. All earned. Yep. All earned. No quibbles whatsoever. From game one. There's something going on. His head's not there. This is just purely observational. His head's not there.
Well, it was a second own goal. He was beaten by Grand Quall for that. Harry van der Sar on the right-hand side for the fourth goal that set up for Halloran.
I mean, this has just been the last in a series of weeks.
Yeah.
Now, they lose Tomoki Imai. They lose Nikolai Topor-Stanley. Two serious bits of personnel to be missing.
Yeah.
Nevertheless... The standard bearer for Western United's rock solid defence was Leo Lacroix.
Yeah.
This time last year, it was the bouquets, all earned. It's got to be brickbat time. Yeah. Like, what the hell is going on there?
Well, again, there are lots of rumours swirling around that Leo wanted to maybe leave during the off season. He had some interest from Europe. It's the same story with Alexander Prijevic, who again
is still not back.
You know, those two players, obviously it's still a team game, and there were players last year, Neil Kilkenny, Jamie Young in particular, one or two others who did ever so well in their championship winning year. But those two were key at either end of the pitch. And this season, Leo Lacroix, as you rightly say, has just not been at the races. Alexander Prijevic, goodness knows what's happening with him. So they're two big holes that you have to fill. I don't honestly know what is going wrong at Western at the moment, but you can't just keep copying goals every week and expecting
14
to win games.
In 14
worst defence in the competition.
Going from best defence to worst defence. The other one, Simon, we can have a quick look back at Brisbane. Huge result for them. We're going to talk about Sydney in a moment ahead of the derby, but for Brisbane, that was a fantastic result for that side. They needed it.
Massive for Brisbane. And they deserved it because the first 10, 15 minutes, quite frankly, I thought they bullied Sydney FC. They did not allow Steve Corica's team to settle. And by the time that they'd shaken the torpor out of their brains and cleared the fog, it was too late. They were 2-0 down. And to be fair to Sydney, they had a much better spell after that. Anthony Caceres got one back and they were pushing for an equaliser in the second half. And then Josh Brindle-South scores a worldie, and it's done and dusted. But again, you can't give teams a two-goal start and expect to get anything out of the game. But that's to Brisbane's credit. They were fantastic at the weekend. And I think you said, Harps, during the call, where's this been all season? And you're right. But, you know, sometimes things go for you. And, you know, they have that early scramble. The free kick comes back off the post and it's played across goal and Charlie Austin scrambles it over the line. And all of a sudden, you've got a bit of momentum. The penalty maybe goes their way as well. Redmayne makes two brilliant saves. And Armiento's there on the follow-up. But no,
and
fully
then
deserved
a stunning third as well.
Fully deserved.
I mean, that Brindle South is not going to score them every day of the week either. Let's catch up one more game from round five with what happened across the ditch in New Zealand. We've got former All Whites goalkeeper Jacob Spoonley, who commentated the match for Sky Sport there. Jacob Spoonley, there were some fantastic goals for the Kiwi crowd to enjoy. But perhaps more importantly in this game against MacArthur, there was a fantastic tribute to Uli Davila's late wife, Lily, wasn't there?
Yeah, look, sometimes football has to take a back seat, and what happened to Lily Davila was absolutely tragic. And fans on both sides of the Tasman wanted to take advantage of the opportunity to acknowledge the grief that Uli is going through and show him support. And it's important to note that the club and the fans will welcome Uli back with open arms at any time. He wasn't able to be there on the weekend, but we did see over social media that the moment did touch him, and that's really important, I think, for us on both sides of the Tasman. In terms of the goals themselves, we saw a first goal for Ben Old, who apparently has the squarest head in the Wellington Phoenix team. So that was additionally challenging for him to get that one into the back of the net. And then another goal for Ben Wayne, and the Wayne train really is rolling through. The pick for me, though, was Clayton Lewis, a 25-yard stunner in off the crossbar. And I've got to say, gents, he was scoring them against me in training for years, so it's wonderful for him to be able to show the league what he can do, really bringing the dead ball to life, as Jason Pine said. We have seen a lot of attention given to the signings that the Phoenix have made, and we have seen good contributions particularly from Craig. But for me, someone who was potentially overlooked is Sam Sutton. He kept Craig Noon very quiet all afternoon, and he added to a portfolio of performances that we saw last season, where he did the same thing against Naboo, Economides, and Craig Goodwin. So three Socceroos that he kept quiet. I think for Ufi, it's another tick. And look, it's a big milestone for the team. They rather stumbled at times in the first four rounds, but they got that win, and they did it in a really comprehensive way. So they ripped MacArthur apart for 5 minutes in that second half. And I think we saw the continuation of a pattern from this Phoenix team, which is that they can go to their bench at any time during a game and change the match. One thing I would like to touch on, and it's something that we noted in commentary, is the wonderful play from Daniel Arzani. But he did seem to have a little bit of petulance at times where he did go down under no contact. Should have got a yellow card. Just wonder what you gents think about that in the studio. Guys, thanks so much for having me. Speaking of young Kiwis that need developing, may as well ask Simon Hill about the first time he shared a camera with young Jacob Spoonley, who had no media training and turned out to be an absolute car crash for the Wellington Phoenix's game against West Ham.
He Simon? Wasn't that bad. That was 2014. It was the Football United Tour, West Ham, Newcastle, Sydney and Wellington. And that was the Spoon's debut. And I thought he was pretty good, actually. I worked alongside Paul Eiffel, and yeah, he did a good job.
Well, it was clearly had the potential because he's great on the Sky Sport commentary every week. Harps, it was nice to see that tribute for Lily Davila. And we know what Uli, well, we can only imagine what Uli's been going through. But football, sometimes, is such a source of contemplation and such an important thing for probably for Uli Davila at the moment as well, to be back playing, to have this family around him. Mm. And that was really beautiful to see his two former clubs come together like that.
Or one current, one former, yeah. Unspeakably sad for Uli, but anyone who's lost family through those circumstances, just unspeakable, really. Mm. But the response from these two football clubs has been excellent. MacArthur have just been enormous. Uli's been enormous for MacArthur, but the response of the squad around him has just been sensational, very heartwarming. And then you go to the Knicks away game, and you know, they've undertaken their own program of supporting and generating mental health awareness, and hence the changed playing strip. And it was just the circumstances of the timing, and it was just beautiful, really. It was really beautiful. I mean, every week we're going to be pouring our heart out to Uli Davila and, by extension, anyone in our community, those too many people who have to deal with this horror. But it was a great response from both clubs.
Football in this part of the world is often a dysfunctional family, but when something like this happens, it normally rallies around its own, and it was great to see.
Yeah, and great to see that it clearly meant so much to the players as well, who stopped the game for a moment, wore that armband with pride, with love, with caring. So, and you can see there have been interviews with Ivan Vujica, we saw with Alhassan Toure after the cup final as well. Just the empathy they all feel and how much they feel for Uli Davila, it is fantastic to see. Let's look ahead to this weekend's round of the A-League men's action. It starts on Friday night with the original rivalry, Melbourne Victory, travelling to Adelaide. Two sides coming off big wins. Simon, huge matchup.
Massive. Love this fixture.
Travelling support there will be, of course.
Travelling support, they'll pack out the Bay. Of course, Cooper Stadium now redeveloped as well, so it's even better. It's the best place to watch football, in my opinion, in the country, particularly when the Reds are at home. Even as commentators, and the Harps will back me up on this, I'm sure, you know, when there's a decision goes against their team, they all look round at the TV booth where we're doing the commentary, go, and if you give them the wrong answer, they're giving us the correct. It's great. So Friday night will be absolutely fantastic. I wouldn't like to sort of guess which way that one's going to go because both teams had big wins at the weekend. So,
Well, let's talk a little bit
point
of form.
Point of order first. Yeah.
Okay, point of order. Point.
Yeah. Can we do a quick rebrand on this game?
What sort of point is this?
It's 0.6. can we move this from the original rivalry, which, you know, is blah, blah, because, you know, it's the Mariners and Newcastle was the original derby, and let's call this...
That's the F3 derby.
Well, yeah, but, you know. Let's call this one the Super Southern Classico. Let's get something a little bit different.
Okay, that's certainly different,
Harps. What's wrong with the original rivalry?
Nothing, I just think the Southern Super Classico is better.
You just think we need rebranding.
Why not?
We need to rebrand.
You know, I don't have a hyphenated surname nor a ponytail, but I do have... but let's talk marketing.
The Super Southern, the SSC.
The Maybe. Super Southern Classico, or the Southern Classico will do me. Any rate, that was the point of order. You can be accept or reject.
Okay.
What was your question?
Let's think about it. My question was, let's very quickly talk form of the two sides. Victory, their final home game before the World Cup. They'd lost their two previous at Amy Park. The crowd was still there supporting them, and they turned it on. It was okay, forget the result. Let's talk about Jake Brimmer's pass. I think that's all anyone really wants to talk about.
Before we get to that, two of the most ridiculous VAR penalty decisions. I don't want to get on the VAR stuff because that's a bottomless pit of controversy. But they did, suffice to say that we were assured that VAR was not going to re-referee incidents. It was clear and obvious.
Hang on, it's coming.
Okay, stop, pause, hold.
Yeah, that's it. It's a thing of beauty.
That's as good as you'll see.
Yeah.
And thankfully, D'Agostino finished it, so the pass does remain concreted in the whole scheme of things.
There's your second VAR call, Andy Harper.
You know, it's just wrong. It's just wrong. Completely wrong. Just get the hell out of the game. If it's an obvious error, come in, do your thing, the offside, blah, blah, blah. But that is just wrong. Completely anti-football.
The law, it's not wrong, though, is it? I mean, I'm not... Look, you know my thoughts on VAR. But by the letter of the law, his arm is away from the body. It's inside the penalty area. It struck his hand.
But it's not going in. It's going straight out of play.
And IFAB needs to be challenged on this point because, you know, they oversee and make the rules for football. That's fine. But you can't... There are some laws in life which are greater than the rules of football. Mm. Like the laws of physics and biomechanics. Like, IFAB can't tinker with that. So reflex actions.
Well, that's not the ref's fault on Friday night, is it? He's got to, apply the rules as
if
they stand.
If they let that go, would that have got through to IFAB head office? I know
well,
our
this
guys.
Is the probably.
This is part of the
no,
problem.
No, but rules then. Are rules. You know, oh. Rules are rules and have to be upheld. Macca was making the point on round ball rules last week, which was if the referee hadn't blown, would there have been any outrage?
That's my point.
Yeah. So would rules you just rules. Play on?
So they never well, actually
there wouldn't have been outrage because of the state of the game at the time, where victory were well clear. But had it been goalless...
Yeah. Well, they were well clear because of another ridiculous penalty.
But, OK, but had it been goalless at the time...
No, I take your point.
From the victory fans.
I take your point, but no, because they haven't rescinded the rule about intent with hand, have they? They haven't rescinded the rule about handball has to be intentional. Now, I know they've modified it in the penalty area, so it's got to be in the silhouette or whatever. Whatever.
No, you still can have accidental handballs and if ball bounces somewhere else.
So if you apply basic understandings of biomechanics, particularly for contact with a hand that's not intentional, clearly not playing at the ball, clearly no reaction time, and it's clearly a biomechanical, it's what you do
when you step.
This is not Seinfeld, right? Where you just walk arms and legs together. You walk, it's biomechanics.
And you also have, if Simon's standing next to you and you guys are running into it, you're going to put your arms
up. Of course.
To stop yourself.
So is it time
yourself?
To simplify the rule? And I've said this before. Any contact with the hand by the defender...
How can you possibly simplify this? I'm just trying to think, how could you possibly...
...is a penalty. Yeah. Then we all know.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter whether it's intentional, unintentional, whether it's stopping a goal or not. Yeah. If it's inside the penalty box and it hits your hand, it's a penalty.
Yeah, maybe.
Then
maybe.
Everybody knows. Now, the counter-argument to that is people say, oh, the players will be scooping the ball up to try and hit it. Well, you know, what's the difference to the controversy that we have now? At least then everybody will know if it hits your hand, it's a penalty. Yeah. Simplify it. We're constantly overcomplicating the rules
exactly
of football.
Exactly right. Yeah. Exactly right.
And the sooner we get back to the basics, I mean, personally, you know my thoughts. Get rid of the VAR. Just go with ref's call. If he calls it, yeah, okay. If he doesn't, you know, that's just the way it goes. Mm. And we'll still argue about decisions, but we won't have 3-4 minute delays where the only thing we have to talk about on TV is a referee peering into a little screen, mouthing inaudible words to somebody who's thousands of kilometres away.
Yeah.
That's not football for me. Mm-hmm. Sorry.
Well, Scotland was introduced to VAR in the last couple of weeks as well, and it didn't go down too well as well. Let's look ahead. It's not the only game on this weekend. There is a huge game, and there is plenty of rumours about already that it's going to be a massive night at Allianz Stadium in Sydney. It's the Sydney Derby. It's Sydney FC versus the Western Sydney Wanderers. You're going to be there, Simon, calling all the action, and it promises to be an absolute cracker, this one.
Hugely excited. Mm. You know, the Sydney Derby, whilst it's remained big in Parramatta, their crowds have been good, it's dropped away for the Sydney FC home games. For understandable reasons, because they've been away from the Sydney Football Stadium. I think part of the attraction for this derby is the return to the SFS, but also, of course, it's the Milos Ninkovic factor. Yeah. And we've already heard lots
Heroes
of stories about fans trying to get pigs' heads in, dead rats. So, you know, he's going to get a warm welcome.
They'll be in the commentary box.
No, just the little snakes, and I'll be eating those. it's going to be fantastic. Right. The atmosphere will be great. And it's an important game for both sides, obviously, as well, on the pitch, because they're both coming off quite damaging defeats. So.
Interesting on the Ninkovic one. So everything Simon says is 100% right. Great anticipation. The one question that remains for me is if the fans get more angry at Ninkovic for leaving or more angry at their own club for letting him leave, in their view. Right?
I think it'll be Ninkovic.
Yeah, I think we can safely say at least for 90 minutes.
Well, what we're hearing so far from a certain section of the crowd, I think you're right. But it's going to be to gauge it, and we'll have to ask you, Simon, to take that barometer for us. Because there is going to be a very voluble protest at Milos Ninkovic, and you wouldn't expect anything less. But outside of that noisy, or how wide, I guess, my question is, how wide does that noisy bubble extend? And what section of the crowd actually is thinking, oh, geez, he should still be with us, and my mob, whom I love, should have done better. But I wonder if there's going to be any of that sentiment.
I think, to be honest, you know, the public pronouncements by Milos, and there's not just been one, there's been two or three or four, you know, he's stuck a knife into Sydney a bit. And he might be completely justified in that. I don't know. But I think that's stuck in the craw of a lot of Sydney FC fans. Mm. You know, say your piece once maybe and then move on. Yeah. But the fact that he's repeated it a few times, I think, has really twisted the knife. Mm. And I think we'll probably see a reaction from the Sydney fans.
Are you expecting any latent residual support for Milos from the Sydney fans who love their club but might be angry with their club for letting him go?
On Saturday? Yeah. No.
No, right, me neither. Right. And he has a great opportunity to get rid of any residual resistance in the Western Sydney Wanderers fans as well, because he remains still, for a lot of people in Australia, the symbol of Sydney FC, even though he has changed. So what better way to endear yourself
that's a question.
To your new fans?
How have you felt the welcome for the Wanderers at the Wanderers for him? I haven't been able to get a sense of that.
I mean, I've done a few Wanderers games, and I've felt that it's been warmish, but you know, he's not really caught fire yet on the field. But what I would say is that, you know, there was a lot made of Ninkovic going to the Wanderers and Jack Rodwell going the other way. Mm. Jack Rodwell's yet to play a minute. He may play at the weekend. Mm. Ninkovic has played virtually 90
nearly every
minutes every
minute.
Week.
Yeah,
so he's contributed. He's not, no goals, no assists, as far as I'm aware, as yet either.
Not yet.
So I think it's a work in progress. And that relationship, it was, I don't think it was ever going to be being clasped to the bosom of the RBB immediately because of his Sydney FC links. Mm. So I think, you know, if he scores on Saturday...
Absolutely.
Well, sets up the winner with 2 minutes to go. Mm. That might change. Mm.
Mm. Let's have a look at all the other matches then coming up this weekend. Only 5 games because Perth's match against Brisbane has been postponed. So the original rivalry, or the great Southern
Classico
super match.
Make it simple, the Southern Classico.
The Southern Classico between Adelaide and Melbourne Victory. The Jets looking to bounce back against the only undefeated side in the country at the moment, Melbourne City, who are looking very, very good. They will have a couple of players heading off to the World Cup, though. Will that affect their performance on the weekend, I wonder? I've been talking about this with a few people around. You know, players don't want to get injured now. You've made the 26. Mm. Sydney FC against Western Sydney. Phoenix entertain Western United. That is a huge match for Western United now, travelling to New Zealand for that one, and the Phoenix are looking very good. And then the Mariners entertain MacArthur as well. The Mariners, did they? I wonder if they showed a bit of the blueprint for how to beat Western Sydney, because Western Sydney have been very tough to beat, and the Mariners really tore them apart time and time again in that, with movement. They look defensively frail, and if the Mariners can keep going, well, that's a... solid performance.
The issue for Sydney ahead of the derby is, of course, their defence looks equally frail. Hopefully that means that we're going to get a high scoring derby, because two defences that, you know, are perhaps a bit vulnerable at times.
Mm-hmm. Well, the Wanderers' defence proved vulnerable on Saturday. Up until then, it was...
they've been good.
It really established a good foundation, but it was a really disappointing collapse from the Red and Blacks. but you know, people underrate the Mariners.
But I think there was a lot of credit just on that point. I think there was a lot of credit given to the Mariners after that game. People were impressed.
As they should be.
So often you think, oh, that was terrible defending. That was poor.
I had them top three this season.
Well done to you.
Pre-season list. Mariners, top three.
Where'd you have the Wanderers?
I had them in the 6, but a little bit further down.
Mm-hmm. Well, Montgomery, the coach, is just proving what a good practitioner he is. I mean... did a great job last year, and you know, it was okay on the back of Alan Stajic, who did a great job himself, before he left. Monty comes in and people were expecting it to collapse. It didn't collapse, but still, he's inherited a good foundation. But Montgomery is carving out his own reputation. This team is going to be incredibly difficult to beat this year. They're not going to win every game, obviously. But I tell you what, they're going to cause all sorts of trouble to every team in the competition.
Yeah. Good stuff. That's it for us today on Round Ball Rules. Huge weekend of action coming up with the A-League and the Matildas, of course. Don't forget, we have a poll running on at Paramount Plus AU, one that's been causing plenty of controversy as well. It's got the soccer Twitter talking. Who's been the best A-League men import this season? Jason Cummings, Joe Lolly, Nani,
interestingly
or Milos
worded
Ninkovic,
poll, isn't it?
Simon. Before we talk about your answer, let's talk about the question.
Cummings an import? B, he's been here for longer than the start of the season. Yeah. And Milos Ninkovic is in there as well. He's been here for donkey's years. So
for you, Lolly or Nani? No, who else would you have had in there?
Charlie Austin's done okay. Marcelo certainly. Valon Berisha, I thought has done okay.
Very good.
He's not set the world on fire yet, but I thought he's done reasonably well. So there's a few candidates. Robert Mack.
Yeah, as well.
Yeah, I'd have probably gone for Mack.
Kraev's got a couple of goals. Harps.
Yep.
Same.
Yep. Same.
Ditto. No problem.
Point nine.
All right. Well, that's it for us today then on Round Ball Rules. We'll be back next week for a review of all the action of round six and the Matildas action, of course, and look ahead to the Sydney Super Cup, because Celtic and Everton are coming to take on Sydney FC and the Western Sydney Wanderers. Gentlemen, thank you very much for your time. It was a pleasure.
Good to see you.
As always.
And we'll see you again soon. Go the Roos.